Yes, beta, very good morning. We were doing Silk Road by Nick Middleton. Let's have a look again at the points. So Silk Road is a travelogue, fine traveling experience of Nick Middleton himself, narrators, you can say, on experience in exploring Mount Kailash, narrator's journey from Rabu to Mount Kailash, from the plains to that mountain area, and how he will be facing a lot of difficulties, how he will be exploring various belts, right? And will be reaching some difficult places as well, and the difficulties he will be facing regarding health issues and food and language. Fine, I'm not going to again tell you about the, you can say, details, because we have done this already in detail. So I'm just going through the points read so far. Then he reaches Hor, finds it a grim place. Then he goes to Darchan. He fell sick over there. His driver, cum guide, Satan, he took him to one of the medical colleges of Darchan, and then he got a 5-day course of Tibetan medicine over there. And he was not able to sleep. He was having his nostrils were blocked, and after having medicine for the first day, he was able to sleep for the first time. So after the breakfast, he had the medicine. It resembled like a cinnamon. So he says, okay, this looks like that powder then. But during afternoon and dinner time, he was not able to, make out what exactly was given to him. So it looked like sheep dung. Then he felt, very bad about it. But anyhow, he had to swallow it because there was no choice. So he, after having medicine, he slept. And he had sound sleep and he was better. Fine. Then he goes to one of the cafes of Darshan, where that was the only cafe over there. And then he meets Norbu at that cafe of Darshan. That's still to be read. Ye abhi padhna hai humne. And he decides to do Kora with Norbu. So characters are already clear to you, narrator himself. Then Satan and Daniel. Daniel is the translator. Satan is the guide come driver. And Norbu is the person we will be reading about today. Clear? We were on this page, Peter. As you can see, page number 80. Is it visible to you all? Once he saw that I was going to live, Satan left me to return to Lhasa. As a Buddhist, he told me he knew that it didn't really matter if I passed away, but he thought it would be bad for business. So when Satan took him to medical college, he saw that, okay, he's fine now. And he says that it doesn't really matter that if, why does it matter that if he dies? Because it will be bad for him. Being into the business of a tourist guide, he earns money out of the visitors only. So if he dies, such people will die and he will not get business. So that's why he made this comment. Darchan didn't look so horrible after a good night's sleep. It was still dusty, partially derelict, and punctuated by heaps of rubble and refuse. But the sun shone brilliantly in a clear blue sky. So when he went to Hor, a Hor was quite a grim place. वहाँ पे बहुत कम लोग थे. So he felt really miserable, but in Darchan it was a little better than the earlier place. So Himalayas commanded by a huge snow-capped mountain, Gorla Mandhata, with just a wisp of cloud suspended over its summit. The town had a couple of rudimentary general stores selling Chinese cigarettes. क्या क्या मिल रहा था general stores में? Cigarettes, soap, and other basic things, as well as the usual strings of prayer flags. In front of me, men gathered in the afternoon for a game of pool. Fine, men gathered in the afternoon for a game of pool, the battered table looking supremely incongruous in the open air, while nearby women washed their long hair in the icy water of a narrow brook that babbled down past my guest house. So he was telling the view from his guest house in Darshan that women were bathing over there, washing their hair in the icy cold water, how men were playing games and at the table. Fine. So that was the scene from his hotel or guest house in Darchan. Darchan felt relaxed and unhurried, but for me it came with a significant drawback. There were no pilgrims. What was the drawback of Darchan? He did not find any pilgrims, fine, religious travelers, like, because he wanted to know Kora, their religious ceremony, you can say he wanted to fulfill his travel. And he wanted that, you know, jab hum kahin ja rahe hote hai, when we meet a person of same bent of mind, they, where they're going in the same place, we become friends with them sometime. We have a better, you can say, connections. And it is easy for us because something, someone like us is going in the same place. So he did not find any person who was going to do Kora. He was going to Mount Kailash. So he was very dejected about this thing. I had been told that at the height of the pilgrimage season, the town was bustling with visitors. Many brought their own accommodation, enlarging the settlement around its edges. As they set up there, you can say, so he got to know that this place is having, you know, many of the pilgrims and visitors will be there, but actually it was not so in reality. So when he went over there, he didn't find many visitors. Many bought their own accommodation. Tents were there, but time by arrival of the beginning of the season, but it seemed I was too early. So usko laga maybe main jaldi aa gaya hu, that's why I could not, you know, find the visitors over there. So that might be the reason. One afternoon, I sat pondering my options. So he was thinking his options over a glass of tea in Darchan's only cafe. So only cafe was there. He was sitting and he was thinking, what will I do? After a little consideration, I concluded they were severely limited. Clearly, I had not made much progress with my self-program on positive thinking. So he, it is a self-help program. He was thinking like positively. He had to think positive because he's all alone. If he will think negative, he will not be able to survive. In my defense, it had not been easy with all my sleeping difficulties, but however I looked at it, I could only wait. The pilgrimage trail was well trodden, but I didn't fancy doing it alone. So that trail, that path where he has to walk and trod, it was very easy. You know, he could go, but it was nice path, but it was like he didn't want to go alone. He wanted a companion ki koi to ho mere saath. The Kora was seasonal because parts of the route were liable to blockage by snow. I had no idea whether or not the snow had cleared, but I was not encouraged by the chunks of dirty ice that still clutched the banks of Darchan's group. Since Satan had left, I had not come across anyone in Darchan with enough English to answer even this most basic question. He was at a place where people do not speak English at all. Only Satan was there, and he has already left his tourist guide, a cab driver. Satan had gone, and he did not have anyone over there who could help him. So even this most basic question that whether the ice is clear or not, to usko koi nahi tha jisse wo baat kar sake. Until that, I met Normu. So this is the man he is going to continue his journey with. The cafe was small, dark, and cavernous, with a long metal stove that ran down the middle. So it was very, you know, cafe was not that a very happening place, having music and looking nice. No, it was very dingy, small, jaise koi caves bane hote hai, with a long metal stove ran down the middle. The walls and ceiling were wreathed in sheets of multicolored plastic of the striped variety, broad blue, red, and white, that is made into stout, voluminous shopping bags sold all over China and in many other countries of Asia as well as Europe. As such, plastic must rate as one of China's most successful exports along the Silk Road today. So he could see plastic decorations, plastic everywhere, because that was through the Silk Road, you know, they would get plastic and very cheaper price drop directly from China. So that can be the reason. The cafe had a single window beside which I had taken a position so that I could see the pages of my notebook. Itna andhera tha andar because it was very small cafe. It was not well lit. So he has taken seat near the window, near the only window. Itna chota tha cafe, ek hi window tha usme. And I had also brought a novel with me to help pass the time. Normu saw my book when he came in and asked with a gesture if he could sit opposite me at Riketi table, you English. So when Normu came, he saw this man was reading English book. He immediately came to him and asked with gestures, usko laga ki you English? He asked, are you already? I told him, yes, I was. And we stuck up a conversation. Then he finally, he got someone to talk to. He and Normu started their conversation. Mitali, will you read it for me, beta? I have highlighted this part. Are you there, Mitali? Who wants to read? Let me check. Yes, Drishti. Drishti, are you there? See, I can cross check at any time. When you are least expecting, the teacher will ask us to unmute. At that time, I mean, who is there? Who could tell me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, Drishti, please read it, beta.
One second. I didn't think he was from those parts because he was wearing a wind cheater and metal rimmed spectacles of a Western style. He was Tibetan and he told me, but worked in Beijing at the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences in the Institute of Ethnic Literature. I assume he was on some sort of field work.
Please underline the character sketch of Norbu, that what sort of man he looked like and what he was wearing from where he was. Okay. Then?
Yes and no, he said. I have come to do the Kora. My heart jumped. Norbu had been writing academic papers about the Kailash Kora and its importance in various works of Buddhist literature for many years. He told me, but he had never actually done it himself. When the time came for me to tell him what brought me to Darchin, his eyes lit up. We could be a team, he said excitedly. Two academies who have escaped from the library, perhaps. My positive strategy was working after all. My initial relief at meeting Norbu, who was also staying in the guest house, was tempered by the realization that he was almost as ill-equipped as I was for the pilgrimage.
What do you mean by...
He kept telling me...
So he was so happy and elated to know that finally he met someone of same interest and he is also going to do religious Kora, and that Norbu also is there for same purpose and he wants to write something about that Kora. But both were not having good equipment with them to carry forward their journey. So he was so happy, both of them were so happy to find each other finally, that then they will be able to continue the journey. Then my initial relief. Continue.
He kept telling me how fat he was and how hard it was going to be. Very high up. He kept reminding me, so tiresome to walk. He wasn't really a practicing Buddhist.
It transpired,
but he had enthusiasm and he was, of course, Tibetan.
So he was, you know...
Although I had originally...
Wait. The narrator was so happy at meeting Norbu, and Norbu was staying in a guest house, you know. And when he got to know that we both share same interests and same sort of situation is there, though he was not a practicing Buddhist, though he was writing about a Buddhist religion, but he was not at all a Buddhist himself. But he had that enthusiasm, you know, that he was, of course, a Tibetan. He says, being a Tibetan, you should know about Buddhism. So that was there. So Tibet people, they follow Buddhism only. So though he was himself was not a Buddhist, right? So even then he was so excited to write about Buddhism and, you know, Marsarovar and Kailash Kora, that how it is associated. So this is the Silk Road, which will be helping them to write about the religion as well. Then,
although I had originally envisaged making the trek in the company of devout believers On reflection, I decided that perhaps Norbu would turn out to be the ideal companion. He suggested we hire some yaks to carry our luggage, which I interpreted as a good sign. And he had no intention of prostrating himself all round the mountain. Not possible, he cried, collapsing across the table in hysterical laughter. It wasn't his style, and anyway, his tummy was too big.
So you can make out that out of the grim situation, Nick Middleton was in a very sad, you can say, situation when he was in horror, and then he came over to Darshan and he was almost having no sleep nights. And then he met Norbu, who was, you know, quite fat and having big tummy, and he was lying on that table and he was doing acting, ki, you know, not possible, hum to pure mountain pe, you know. He was making cracking jokes. So out of in such situation, when you meet someone who's making you laugh, so that made author's day. So Nick Middleton was so happy to meet Norbu because Norbu was making him laugh, as well as he was telling him ki that yaks will carry our luggage. It is not possible for us. So yaks, you know, the animals which are quite easily found in such areas. Then it is over. Fine. So why they have ended this chapter, you can mute yourself, Bitta. Now you will be telling me, we will be discussing the question answers, okay? And along with that, you will tell me that why author ended, he's not continued, you know, he has not continued this chapter, but he has just got a partner. So he was searching for, he met the partner and finally he was so happy. He met a lot of people, the girl who gifted him sheepskin coat, then Satan, his driver plus guide, then Daniel, his translator, then he met the doctor at, you can say, Darshan Medical College. Then finally, when he was all alone, he was feeling miserable and sad, but he did not let his positive thinking fall down. He was so positive that he believes that if we think positive, positive will happen, that aura becomes positive. So out of that positive thinking, yes, definitely that, you know, positive attracts positive. So finally he gets to meet Norbu at the only cafe of Darshan, who was in the same, who was, both were sailing in the same boat. It means both wanted to do that pilgrimage to Kailash, Mount Kailash. Both were curious, though the purpose of, and both were, you know, having that academicians, that background, that writers, both of them. And he, though Norbu was not a Tibetan, not a Buddhist himself, but he was a Tibetan. He was so much, very much into this, knowing about this religion and Kora, and he wanted to write about in his academic papers. So both of them share common bent of mind also, you know, the common profession and interest. And then he made him laugh, and then they decide to do Kora with Norbu. They have not completed their journey. Their purpose is, you know, journey is more important than destination. Fine. Raaste zyada maine rakhte manzil se. How you're reaching there to your destination, you know, destination will come, then what next? Right? If you have reached your destination, what next? It's over. Your journey is over. So it's always about the journey which will teach you. Destination is not going to teach you anything. That is the end point. So journey is going to teach you always that what you have learned throughout. So this travelogue has taught Nick Middleton a lot of things that many, yes, we have to be well prepared for all sorts of situations. We have to be tough in circumstances. We have to have positive thinking. We have to be well equipped with all the luggage and whatever things required. Basically, Silk Road. Fine. That how they explored that Silk Route, which had ancient importance as well as importance these days as well. Fine. Now we will discuss the question answers, Bitta. You know that we have another period as well. So you can see the article has been titled Silk Road, Give Reasons. Question already upar hi likh diya hai. Chaliye, who will give me the answer to this? Ye to maine aapko bahut baar bata diya hai. the importance of this silk route. Yes, Gursimran, bataiye why the article is titled Silk Road. Are you there? Gursimran, jiski turn aayegi wo bhagta jayega na, aise hi hoga. Nahi aata hai to even then you can say that. Yes, Divnur.
Ma'am, the article, it has been titled The Silk Road because there was a trade of silk and other precious stones and various things between India and China. The trade took place from this route. And also the author, he went on a pilgrimage to Mount Kailash.
So basically, answer is given by you already. So we need not, you can say, add more into this. So the basic answer is this only. Yes, Divnur, that article is titled Silk Road because of the protagonist explored the old silk route, which was one of the historical routes for trade. So he explored that silk route, which was, one of the prominent historical routes for trade. It was commonly known, which was famous. And between many places of India and you can say China and other Afro-Eurasian land. And what sort of trade was done? Like Chinese silk, spices, tea, porcelain, Indian textiles, pepper, precious stones, Roman Empire gold, silver, glassware, wine, carpets, and many jewelry also. So many things. List is, numerous things are there which were being exported and imported. So that route was there for mainly business purposes, commercial purposes. So that's why article has been titled Silk Road, and author is going to explore that Silk Road after many years. Excuse me. Give reasons why Tibetan mastiffs were popular in China's imperial courts. What are Tibetan mastiffs? They are big hunting dogs, right? Mastiffs, Tibetan mastiffs are huge hunting dogs. Jo shikar karne ke liye kaam aate. Yes, Anjali, if you can answer this. Why they were famous in China's imperial courts?
They were famous because they are used for the hunting purposes, and they are very huge and with the massive jaws, and they are as fast as a bullet.
Yes,
they can, and
very good. So we can add up more points into it. You can mute yourself, Anjali. So in this matter, Tibetan mastiffs were popular in China's imperial courts because they are very huge hunting dogs. Actually, they are called hunting dogs. They were fearless. They were ferocious and furious. They had big jaws, and they were brought along the Silk Road as a watchdog from Tibet. तो उनको ए वॉच डॉग की तरह माना जाता था, दोज हु टेक केयर ऑफ द यू कैन से सिक्योरिटी एंड ऑल. सो दे वर बीइंग यूज्ड एज वॉच डॉग फ्रॉम तिब्बत. दे वर आल्सो ब्रॉट अलोंग द सिल्क रोड. सो दे वर एक्चुअली अ ट्रिब्यूट इन एंशिएंट टाइम्स दैट दे वर सो मच यूजफुल, एंड दैट्स व्हाई यू कैन से दे वर पॉपुलर इन चाइनाज इंपीरियल कोर्ट्स, दैट बिकॉज ऑफ देयर यू कैन से ब्रेवरी एंड वेलर एंड फेरोशियसनेस. Give a reason for the following statement. The author's experience at Hor was in stark contrast to earlier accounts of the place. Means what he read about the place Hor and actually what he experienced, there is a lot of difference. Why? Yes, Ramanjeet. Ramanjeet, please give the answer.
Ma'am, author's experience was in stark contrast, because the author used to he had read some old accounts of people that visited the Mansarovar, and
yes, very good.
And they wrote about the splendid beauty of the place, but the author was very shocked to see the unhygienic conditions of the place.
Yes, the only cafe was there, and concrete was there, broken windows. Yes, very good. So yes, you will add up into this that horror was, you know, was definitely in stark contrast to earlier accounts of the place, because it was an ugly, miserable place which had no vegetation, and it was full of dust and rocks. And even his car suffered two punctures over there, the same place. And it was scattered with gathered refuse. And, you know, he had heard a lot about Lake Mansarovar, that which is Tibet's most respected holy water. And, you know, four rivers of India, they are considered to be the source from Mansarovar. But even, you know, when even they have mentioned that a Japanese monk named Ikai Kawaguchi has mentioned that he became so emotional on seeing this Mansarovar. And same one of the more saint or Swedish saint, he also said that he also became emotional after seeing this Mansarovar. But author did not feel so. He felt that only cafe was there, broken windows in that cafe. It was painted badly, very less vegetation. No proper hygienic conditions were there, and he didn't like the place at all. Rest beta bell ho chuki hai. We will continue these questions in the next period, in the sixth period. Please join accordingly. Okay, have a nice day.